Hello everyone, welcome to the EPG Pathshala. I am Dr. Rajeshwari Moganti, professor at the Department of Biochemistry at All India Institute of Medical Sciences at New Delhi. The module we are going to cover today is on thermoregulation introduction. Now this module comes in the paper on thermodynamics of living systems and bioenergetics. Now, why do you think the thermoregulation should be studied? The thermoregulation is an important aspect because all the body functions, the cells, the enzymes, everything works at a particular temperature. If the temperature is changed, the enzymes don't work and therefore the cell dies. So it is very, very crucial that the cell maintains the temperature and therefore the body maintains a particular temperature. That is why thermoregulation is one of the most important and crucial factors of the thermodynamics. So the learning objectives in this module are, what are the various mechanisms of the heat loss and what mechanism, different mechanisms the body loses heat to maintain the temperature, and physical aspects as well as the physical chemistry aspects of the heat related to the heat loss, that is by radiation, evaporation, conduction and convection. Now having done the heat loss, to maintain the body temperature, body also has to produce the heat. So what are the heat production methods in the body, whether glucose metabolism and all those things. Now to do all these things, the different organs are working hard to maintain the temperature of the body. Now what are the roles of the skin in evaporation, conduction, etc., and role of the muscle, the central nervous system, that is the CNS, which controls all the signals, and also the basic metabolic rate, then the hormone levels, all these will be contributing to the temperature maintenance, that is a thermoregulation. Now having done in an adult system the thermoregulation, we have to consider the newborns in a very different way, because the newborns haven't really got all the organs completely developed, or the cells which are not having the fully developed state. Therefore, the newborns have to maintain the body temperature, and that's very, very critical because it is a just born newborn. So we will be dealing this in a different module. Now, having done with the humans and the newborns, we have to consider the animals have a different way of maintenance of the temperature. The animals having a different metabolic rate, different mechanisms. Therefore, the endotherms, how do they maintain the temperature? The ectotherms, how do they maintain temperature? We will also be doing one of these objectives. Then, having done all these by understanding from the point of view of the biophysics, we have to see that how can you calculate the body, how much radiation that is giving or how much energy that is giving. So this is a fundamental aspect of the biophysics of the thermoregulation. So you will be using a number of equations, and based on those equations, you should be able to solve and determine how the amount of energy that is radiated. So these are the basic objectives which you will be dealing in this thermoregulation. What is thermoregulation? Now, thermoregulation is the balance between heat loss and heat produced by the organism. The term thermoregulation is sometimes also referred as temperature homeostasis. Now, what is homeostasis? Homeostasis is a property of the system in which the variables are regulated so that the internal conditions remain stable and relatively constant. The core temperature of the human body. The core temperature of the human body is maintained between 36.5 degrees to 37.5 degrees centigrade, which in terms of the Fahrenheit, it is called 97.7 to 99.5 degree Fahrenheit. So this is the range, but generally the body temperature is expressed as 37 degrees centigrade or 98.6 degree Fahrenheit. Now, what is the conditions under which the body temperature maintains at this particular temperature? Now, the conditions are very clear. that the body is in a very, very comfortable position, comfortable conditions, like there is no exertion, there is no activity, and for example, you are sleeping or even taking rest. During this time, there is no exertion. Basically, the metabolic rate is very, very normal and in normal conditions. So the important thing is that one person also has to be in a very healthy state. So these are the conditions under which we say that the core temperature of the human body is at 37 degrees centigrade. So now what we have understood is the body's temperature, which is maintained at 37 degree under healthy conditions without exertion. But there are also terms we must have come across called hypothermia and hyperthermia. As the name suggests, hypo means low and hyper means high. So these terms can be used in conjunction with any other parameter. And here what we call it as a hyperthermia. Hyper means high. So what is high? The body temperature goes up, now above the normal temperature, that is a healthy state condition. Now this is a condition where you have a fever or an infection, or even in some diseases like stroke. These are the conditions, any kind of a disease condition, the body temperature can go up. And all of you one time or the other might have experienced that there is a high temperature. But if the body temperature goes beyond 105 or 107 degrees, then it becomes very, very severe and the person can have a life-threatening state. Under such conditions, one has to see the doctor. Otherwise, normally take the temperature. For bringing down the temperature, you are used to take the paracetamol or lowering the temperature. But that again does not take away the disease. It is only temporarily decreasing the body temperature, because the cellular function as well as the body function totally will be imbalanced, and there will be a very crucial state if the body does not maintain the temperature. So it is necessary for the body to come to normal temperature before it is attacked by the other organisms or any other bacteria or any other infection. So the hyperthermia can be very life-threatening state. Now, having learned the hyperthermia, it is the opposite, the hypothermia. Now, the hypothermia, that is a lowering of temperature below the body temperature, is also can be a life-threatening. But under normal condition, the body fights back and brings it back to the body temperature. Now, any temperature below 98.6 degrees can be called as a hypothermia. Now, there can be different states, a kind of mild or a medium, or it could be a severe hypothermic state. Now, the mild hypothermia is generally referred if the temperature of the body, core temperature, goes below or up to 96 degrees. That is from 98.6 degrees to 96 degrees. Now, the moderate is the one where it goes to up to 93 degrees. From 95 to 93, you can call it, can be considered, in that range is considered as a hypothermic state, which is in the moderate state. Now, again, the life-threatening is something very, very critical. That is, it reaches even 86 degrees Fahrenheit. So, this has to be really taken care immediately, needs immediate attention by the doctors. Now, let us see what are the conditions that can lead to or create a hypothermic condition. Now, it is a very common and sensible thing that understand that it is an improper clothing. If you are not wearing a proper woolens in a winter day and a low temperature, and then that can lead to a hypothermia. Maybe a mild or maybe a moderate one, but still the improper clothing will actually help in maintaining the temperature. The next point is that below freezing and lack of equipment. People who go on to the high altitude places, if they are not having a proper equipment, the body can go into a hypothermic condition. Although it is very common that if you stay on a rainy day in wet clothes for a long duration and the environment temperature is not very, very low, even then one can lead to a hypothermic condition depending on the age and other factors. But definitely wetness for a long duration
is one of the causes. The other factor is fatigue and exhaustion. These things play a role if the person is not having enough metabolic rate, high rate. That means is not having enough carbohydrate intake, and therefore there is no glucose, there is no high energy, that is the production is less, therefore can lead to a hypothermic condition. And one of the very common things is the dehydration is also an important factor. Poor food intake, particularly control in containing the carbohydrate or a fat, then the body again will have low levels of energy. So it can lead to hypothermic condition. Old age, particularly in winter, they are very, very prone to catch cold and the body temperature can go low. And then can lead to this in these people, the peripheral circulation problems will be there. And they also can lead to the clinical conditions which are called trench foot and also called sometimes in a common name, the frostbite. So these are some of the common conditions where a human body can go to hypothermic state.
Now, what are the factors that actually influence in maintaining the body temperature? A number of factors. We'll see one by one. And firstly, the nature of the living organism, whether it is humans or an animal, or it could be an animal living at a different temperatures. So each one has its own way of maintenance of the temperature. Then comes the next, age. Now, age is one of the very, very important factor. You must have seen that the old people feel very cold or hot in a very, very short time, and their maintenance of the temperature is not very good. That is because the skin is actually lost its fat, and there is a vascularity is less. Then the cellular function is also not very good, and therefore the fat is not enough. Therefore, the skin thickness, epidermis also becomes very small. Therefore, they find it very difficult either to retain their body temperature or even to give out or the radiate the when they are in a other temperature, depending on the external temperature. So, age is an important factor. Now, the next is the surface area, body surface area. Now, this is a very important, because if the surface area is high, and a larger area, the radiation or the heat emission, heat loss mechanisms will be very effective. Now, this other one is a body mass. Body mass, it actually has been seen that the body mass is higher and then the volume is higher. They actually, this kind of living organisms, for example, you know that the polar bear lives in a very cold atmosphere, that is in a very low temperatures. That is, the body is built up in such a way that the mass is very high, and of course the surface area is less. Therefore, the body mass is actually evolutionarily brought up in such a way that the animal can actually keep its own temperature, retain temperature, and that helps in the body, maintaining the body temperature. Now, hormonal levels, I think this is one of the very important factor. The hormonal levels play a very important role. And again, the hormonal levels are actually controlled by the CNS, that is the central nervous system. So these two work actually in conjunction. And metabolic state, if you have taken good food, carbohydrate level is very high, then your high energy levels are there, and therefore it is, you know, energy production methods are taken care properly. And physical activity, we'll be doing this in a much more detail in a later stage, in later part of this module. And physical activity is high, obviously the heat production is more, and therefore the heat loss mechanism will be more, a loss mechanism will be higher. This circadian rhythm, you might have seen that in a night temperature when you are sleeping or in the during the day, these circadian rhythms actually also contribute to the body temperature. In maintenance, it is maintained, but in a slight fluctuations will be there. Now the external temperature, obviously now you are sitting in a AC room or in a very comfortable position, then of course the radiation loss or the gain is not actually seriously perturbed, and the body maintains it well. But suppose you are staying in a very hot temperature, like for in a hot sun or something, the body temperature has to be maintained, and for that the body has to work. So the external temperature, either it is hot or cold as compared to the body temperature actually also determines the temperature, helps in maintaining the, influences the body temperature. Now the infections or a disease, during this also the body temperature can go up. You also must have felt sometime or the other when you are sick, the body temperature goes up. So the actually to maintain the body temperature, the body actually works in a very very synchronized manner by maintaining various parameters.
It is very interesting.
So these
actually,
are the gross or the main parameters that actually
living
influence the
planet
body temperature
Earth,
to be at a constant.
They actually live in a very large number of organisms. They actually live in a very narrow range, that is between 10 to 30 degrees. So the evolutionarily the organisms have developed around this temperature. Now in this figure you see that the red area, that is mostly the central part of the world, is between the, where the organisms survive between 10 to 30. Of course the polar regions, which are cold temperatures, there are some organisms but very less of number of organisms. The thermoregulation. The thermoregulation, whenever there is a regulation, it means it has to be maintained. Maintained between what? The heat loss and heat gain. Now there is a very, very good fulcrum between heat loss mechanisms and heat gain mechanisms. On your left, you see that there is a heat loss where it is maintained by evaporation, radiation, conduction and convection. Whereas in heat gain mechanisms, you have heat production by the carbohydrate metabolic, or by exercise, again you will increase the metabolic rate, or shivering, one of the very common phenomena or the body's own mechanism to bring back the temperature to the normal, and that is the shivering in cold temperatures. And of course external heat, suppose you have kind of staying in a heater, in front of a heater in winter conditions, that external heat also helps in bringing back the temperature to the normal. So there is a very nice fulcrum that is maintained by the body, beautifully maintained between heat loss and heat gain mechanisms. Now we just saw that the mechanisms of heat loss are grossly four major mechanisms. Now this slide shows you the mechanisms which are the radiation, for example, just an animation to show you that the radiation could be a source, like for example from sun, or the radiation, the second mechanism is the evaporation, that where you evaporate particularly on a hot day, and the convection, where the convection currents occur, and that is one of the mechanisms, and the other one, last one, is the conduction, that when you touch something directly conducts, the heat conducts. So these are the mechanisms of the heat loss. Now when you have seen these four major mechanisms of radiation, conduction, convection and the radiation, but in addition to that, when a person is under exercise or there is a mechanism in which he or she is having a higher metabolic rate, for example, this slide shows you that a person is running and a marathon. So that means he is having metabolic rate is very high. So one reason that heat is lost is by radiation. The second one is the natural convection. However, here you have another one that is called forced convection. Now the forced convection is actually arising from the foot that is running. During running, the foot is touching the floor, the ground, and therefore during that momentum, there is an additional convection that is generated, that is called the forced convection. So in addition to the natural convection, you have a forced convection which is contributing. Now of course the exhalation of the warm and moist gases also one of the mechanism that it is high increased in this state. Now the evaporation and the warm moist air, these are the mechanisms which are in addition to the normal that you see it in a very active state, for example in a running or in a during gym or any other exercise. Let us see what are the heat mechanisms and how the body is actually, what are the organs of the body that contribute into these different four mechanisms of heat loss. Now the first was radiation. radiation, the involvement of the body part is skin, and in the convection, both the smooth muscles and skeletal muscles actually contribute. In conduction, the skin is a major part. Again, in evaporation, the skin, the sweat glands actually and contribute. But in addition to that, the lungs also help in the evaporation of the heat loss mechanism. Now, when you see this, the normal environmental conditions, all these mechanisms are normal, that they all play part in controlling the temperature. However, let us see that what happens in the high temperature. What in high temperature, which organ is contributing to what extent? Now, the radiation is low, that is understandable. Now, the convection will be high because there is a, you are at a high temperature, and the high temperature is actually contributed by the smooth muscles by convection. Now, therefore, there is a vasodilation of the muscles, and in conduction, because there is a high surface area, the blood flow will be increasing and therefore helps in conduction. Evaporation, increase in sweat, therefore there is a more loss of heat in these four conditions. So each one is a actually increased levels, convection, conduction and evaporation. However, the point to be noted here is the radiation does not have much of a contribution. Now let us see, on contrary, what happens when there is a low temperature. The low temperature, the radiation will be high, whereas in convection, the muscles do contribute, but it is not the smooth muscle, but it is skeletal muscles, and there is a lot of vasoconstriction. And in conduction, again, it will be very low, and evaporation, obviously, again, will be low. So the mechanisms which partake, the organelles which take part in different temperatures exposed to conditions, whether high or low, are basically different contribution levels of contribution will be there, both by skin or muscle or by the lungs and etc.
See, now we have understood what are the various mechanisms that a body actually uses in losing the heat or the heat loss mechanisms. So in that, the first one we will be dealing in more detail, that is a radiation. In this module, we will do what is radiation and how it can help in losing the heat by the body. Now, when a term comes as a radiation, what do you understand by radiation? Now, in simple terms, one can say that radiation is just a form of energy that is coming from one source and travels. It could be through a medium like air, or it could be water, or it could be even space, because the sunlight is coming from space. So any form of the medium, the radiation, light is energy, a form of energy that is traveling. So that is what is radiation. Now, having understood what is radiation, now what type of, how many types of radiation are there? Basically, this classification is based on the energy. Now, the ionizing radiation is one. The other one is the non-ionizing radiation. Now, ionizing radiation, we will be dealing in much more detail under the chapter on radiation biophysics. However, I would just like to just make one statement that ionizing radiation is basically ionizes the ions when the radiation passes through a light or the any medium. However, when you have an non-ionizing radiation, when we say that it is does not give any harmful this thing, and it is only a light or a heat or a sound, which can be considered as a different types of radiation. So they are not ionizing the ions which is now present the in the medium, whichever
is
by the
humans
medium.
Is actually in the infrared region of the electromagnetic spectrum. The electromagnetic spectrum actually can be different energies, starting with the high energy, that is the gamma rays on your left side of the spectrum, can lead up to, can go up to low energy, that is short wave AM. Now the wavelength at which, or in the range in which the humans emit radiation, is in the infrared region, that ranges from 0.75 to 1000 microns. Micron is actually 10 to the power minus 6 meters. Now this animation, this figure shows you that actually the human body emits a highest in the frequency of infrared radiation. So this is another quantitatively depicting the intensity versus the wavelength. You see the maximum is around in this, the UV region, the IR region, that is the infrared region. At this stage, it is very, very important, and in this context, it is important to learn the Stefan Boltzmann law. Now, when we talk about the radiation, the first thing comes to mind is a black body radiation that was actually introduced by the Stefan Boltzmann law. Now, using this equation, we can calculate the total energy that is emitted at all wavelengths by the black body. That is given by E equal to sigma T to the power 4. So the sigma is actually the Stefan Boltzmann constant, 5.6705 into 10 to the power minus 5 ergs centimeter minus 2 and k to the power minus 4 and second per inverse minus 1. Now this equation where T is the temperature expressed in absolute temperature, that is the degree Kelvin. Now, for hot objects, other than the ideal radiators, the law is expressed where E is actually 1. So, what does E say? The E is actually to tell you that the emissivity object, if it is an ideal object like black body, the E will be 1. And if the depending on the body that is emitting, any object that is emitting, the E can be from 0 to 1, which are non-ideal. So, the ideal body is the black body, which is considered as E equal to 1, that is the emissivity of the object. So the Stefan Boltzmann law, who has first given this law, is by the two great scientists of physics, Joseph Stefan and Ludwig Boltzmann. The Stefan Boltzmann law, because it is named after these discoverers, this provides the relationship between the luminosity of an object and its temperature, that is the emissivity and surface area. So this particular equation where emissivity is a dimensionless number, that is a ratio of the energy of the object, actually radiates to the energy of the object that would radiate if it were a perfect emitter. This again explains that the perfect emitter is only the black body, which has E1. So this is a very good equation which is used for number of cases where there is a radiation that is emitted by any object. Now the sigma is a proportionality constant which is mentioned to you just now, that it is called the Stefan Boltzmann constant.
See, now you have learned what is Stefan Boltzmann law and what is it used for to calculate the radiation, that is a energy that is emitted by any body, whether it could be a black body. Actually, they have determined for the black body. But now, what is the purpose of learning this is actually to know that how much radiation the body emits. Now, biophysics is all about quantification. You want to know an adult how much energy can give out. So this is what we are going to do, the calculation of power, that how much the body emits.
Now let us use Stefan Boltzmann law and try to calculate what is the amount of power that is emitted by a human being. Now the total emitted power emitted by an object or a body is given by the Stefan Boltzmann law, P equal to A into sigma to the T to the power 4 into E, where E is considered as 1, sigma is the Stefan Boltzmann constant, and T is expressed in the absolute temperature, that is a degree Kelvin. Now use this and let us calculate the power emitted by a human being. So the net power radiated. Now why is the net power we are calculating? Because the body temperature is at a particular temperature, that is T, and the environment of the temperature is T ambient. So the human body has a one temperature and present in presence of an environment that is a T ambient. So the difference will tell you the net power. So now the net power will be very simple to understand, P net equal to A into E into sigma T to the power 4 minus T power ambient. Now let us calculate for a human being, E is the surface area, that is, E is a constant, the emissivity constant, which we considered as approximately 1, and A is the surface area, 1.2 meter square. If this is 1.2 meter square is considered for a normal healthy adult of a height of, say, for example, male, which is having a high 1.2 meter square, whereas the normal body temperature is 37 degrees, which is converted to in degrees Kelvin, it is 310 degree Kelvin. 273 plus 37, that is 310 degree Kelvin. And the ambient temperature is 22. Again, 273 plus 22 is 295 degree Kelvin. So, the P net will be, sometimes can be positive or negative. But here, of course, it is, you have to calculate the positive power, net power, that is calculated and comes out to be about 81 watts. However, I would like to mention that the P net can be positive or negative depending on the emission of the radiation of the body, whether the temperature of the body is high or low compared to the ambient temperature.
Now, we have now done that what is the amount of radiation energy that is emitted by a body and under normal healthy conditions. Okay, but let us do one example. Suppose you are a patient and you are having a very high temperature and having an infection or something like that, and that body temperature will be high, maybe say 100 degree or above 100 degree. So the temperature is, body temperature is high, and suppose a person is admitted in a hospital, in a say ICU. So the room temperature, that is the ambient temperature, is much lower. AC room would be around say 24, 25, 23 degree centigrade, any one of them. So now we like to calculate, I would like you to calculate that what is the net power of the radiation that is emitted by a person who is having a fever and the body temperature is high and in an environment which is much lower temperature. So by using the same Stefan Boltzmann law, you should be able to calculate the body temperature and the body temperature and the environment temperature. So you have T1 and T2. Okay, now let's do this question.
Now let us calculate. You can note down this question, and for a minute after reading the question, you can pause the video that you are watching, calculate and come back to the solution. Now the question is, what is the net power emitted by an adult whose body temperature is 40 degrees and admitted in a hospital whose ambient temperature is 24 degrees centigrade. Now for your ready convenience, I am giving you the values, that is, A is 1.2 meter square, a normal individual, and E is 1.0 sigma, that is the Stefan Boltzmann constant. Now you calculate the value, that is, what is the net power emitted by an adult. You have completed your exercise, and let us look into the solution. The option A, the 22, if you have got this answer, your calculations are correct, but you will lose one mark because you have not introduced the units, which is an important factor. Without the units, it has no meaning. So the first answer, if you have got 22, the answer is wrong. Next one is B, 22 watts. Suppose you have got this answer correct, you will get full marks. However, if you got the answer C, 24 watts, or the answer fourth, D, that is 40 watts, then there is something wrong in your calculation or your understanding. So you must go back and learn the equation again and do the calculation.
See, now we have calculated the energy that is emitted by the body. Now we know that actually the body emits radiation in the infrared region. This also we have learned. Now, what is the advantage or the technique that we exploit the property of the radiation given by a human body in the IR region? Now, this is used for a diagnostic purpose in clinical clinics, that how to identify the disease. So, that technique is called the thermal imaging.
The thermal imaging of a human body can be seen in this IR emission by the body can be seen in this picture. When you look at this right side figure, the upper part shows the full length body, that is the which shows different color codes, red to light gray or the light blue. This actually tells you that the temperature of the body, core temperature, which shows that actually it is a different variation is there. Red shows 33 and the gray is about 22 degrees. For example, that same thing can be seen more clearly in the lower part of that where his arm has been shown. The red is the palm shows a higher temperature, whereas compared to the inner part of the body, that is a hand, which is showed light green. And therefore, the right side scale shows you the temperature, the color coding to the conversion to the coding, that is the temperature to the color code. Now, this digital infrared thermal imaging, we can use it for the diagnosis of a human disease, applications in disease diagnosis. So, the first one, you see that the breast abnormalities like breast cancer can be clearly diagnosed with the help of a thermal imaging. The arrow indicates the red, that is the right side breast having the tumor or abnormality. And now the thyroid abnormalities can also be diagnosed using the thermal imaging. So the third case is the peripheral vascular disease. Again, you can see that the imaging can help in diagnosis of the disease. And the fourth is the cerebral vascular. It's very clear the red area pointed is the disease area. The fifth is the musculoskeletal disease where the abnormalities again are shown. The sixth, the inflammation or the neoplastic condition. Neoplastic means basically cancer or where is the cells are metabolizing faster. So there is a high metabolic rate and therefore there is a higher energy and therefore the radiation will also be high. So these red areas are can be used for a diagnostic purpose in diagnosing the human disease. The major advantages and disadvantages of thermal imaging, the disadvantage, it is only a supportive imaging method but cannot be considered as solely diagnostic. Now it can be used with along with the X-ray which gives structural information and therefore it is not a highly dependable technique. Nevertheless, the advantage is that you need to do a screening of a large population. For example, in airports, you want to screen patients with the diseases or an infection or a bacterial infection or any kind of allergies. They are very useful. You can just quickly say that the person is having a defect, that is a disease or not. But it cannot be solely dependent. But the advantage again is that it can be useful in screening in a large population. So these two advantages and disadvantages have to be kept in mind before using and depending on the thermal imaging.
So now just let us recap what we have learned in this introductory chapter module on thermoregulation. Now thermoregulation is basically the maintenance of the body's core temperature which is maintained in a very narrow range, that is around 37 degrees centigrade. Okay. Now the heat loss and heat mechanisms actually work very closely and there is a very good fulcrum maintained between the heat loss and heat mechanisms in order to maintain the temperature at body temperature 37 degrees. Now the extreme hypothermia as well as hyperthermia can be very, very fatal. Can be fatal and also life-threatening. Now, the other factors that is maintenance of the body temperature, a lot of number of factors that actually contribute, that is the age, the surface area of the body mass, and hormonal levels. Of course, the hormonal levels in association with the CNS, that is the central nervous system, and metabolic rate. For example, in a physical activity, the metabolic rate is high. So all these parameters actually contribute or decide the body temperature. Now the circadian rhythms is another important factor. Now also the external temperature, for example, in a disease state, which is in under infection or in any kind of a body's metabolism defect is there. these conditions actually control the factors in thermoregulation. Now, you also have learned that what are the mechanisms by which the energy is lost. And one of the important one is radiation, which is dealt in much more detail in this class. And in radiation is actually two types, one you ionizing and the non-ionizing radiation. And the human body actually gives non-ionizing radiation in the infrared region. So now we also calculated that how much energy that is emitted by the body using the Stefan Boltzmann law that is given to you in this class. Now, based on this, that is the non-ionizing radiation, infrared region is given by human body. So can we exploit this property to determine the clinically diagnose some of the diseases? So we have learned the technique called thermal imaging. Now, this is actually a display of the amount of IR that is emitted by the human body. So we use this technique and learn that how can you detect the cancer or any other abnormalities in the body. So with this, we end this module on thermoregulation, the introductory part, and in much more detail we did with the radiation. Thank you.